Good morning. I call the Saline County Commission Public Forum and Meeting of March 31st, 2015 to order. Will everybody stand for the flag salute and a moment of silence?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Will the clerk call the roll?
Commissioner Shadwick.
Here.
Commissioner Guile.
Here.
Commissioner Price.
Here.
Commissioner Larson.
Here.
And Commissioner Smith.
Here.
Thank you.
It's time for the public forum where citizens may speak on any issue not on the current agenda, and it's normally limited to 3 minutes. Is there anyone that would like to come forward at this time?
Please, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners, Wayne Montgomery, 2308 Village Lane in Saline County.
Yeah.
Okay. I'm first and foremost a Saline Countyan. I'd like to add to your considerations in the event that this has not been processed as a part of it in terms of term limits. I had a long history with this Planning Commission. Was asked to be on it many years ago and served for several years, left it for a year, and they came back and said, we want your experience on the commission. That was when some new ones were coming in and it was all new to them as it had been to me. When I first came on that planning commission, there were those that had started with its beginning under Morris in 77 or somewhere in there and had served and continued to serve through about 24, 26 years. Their experience proved valuable to us throughout that time, and one of them was very pliable and one of them was not. But when I look at all that we considered through those years, there was one factor that kept emerging, and that was we were constantly called upon to make decisions, which is no different than that which you serve here and in prior positions which you have held. Those factors in making a quality decision were brought home to us because the planning director at that time gave us a booklet. And it was telling us how in that position on Planning Commission, we were serving in a quasi-judicial function. That means you make decisions. So when that comes down to prior members, there were those who vacated the position after two meetings because they could not face public and make decisions. A farm realtor who saw farmers out here, and that was business. Another well-known businessman in the city of Salina could not stand the pressure, and he resigned. If you can't make a decision, you don't need to be in this position or any of the other, whether it's elected or whether it is volunteer. So whenever we come to this situation of term limits, I think that term limitation is in place where it ought to be, elected officials. Involuntary people helping serve our community, our county, that term limits oftentimes cheats the whole process of being productive and understanding what it is all about. It's about down to three, Monty?
We're at three.
Okay, let me quickly limit it then, because that's the main statement I wanted to make, that there's a function, and it's difficult sometimes to get volunteers to do that functioning position as a commission person. So the other thing that I mentioned is, as I was leaving this morning in a coffee situation, one person said, I just wish that we'd get our city and county together and we need to start working on it. And I said, where have you been? The Salina Journal's been wanting that for 12 years. But then I enumerated what I saw as some of the sacrifices that are self-induced, and I saw some of the benefits that are never considered. And there's never been a projection of the future as well. Thank you, Commission.
You bet. Anyone else that would like to talk today on something that's not on the agenda? Yes. I know.
Karen Shade, 111 Wisconsin. Changing topics completely. Back in November, this board approved what is known as Amendment 5 to the Jails Food Service Management Company contract. In that situation, there was a request for action. The amendment was voted on in study session. The public was available. Last week, there was an Amendment 6. There was no RFA. It occurred in a public setting, but what I think is incredibly odd is that it's only today, just 5 minutes ago, Rita Deister mentioned that now I'll be able to view that amendment. In those circumstances, you've got a rather lengthy report about the jail food service management from me perhaps last night. The only thing that kind of is of concern is with the change in board and the change in the way that you're handling things like this, it does make a person wonder what's going on. And if my mind goes to the worst case scenarios possible, I find myself asking, have any of you as the board received any political contributions or in-kind contributions or whatever from CBM Managed Services? And this gets a little more tricky for Mr. Chadwick, because you own a business where there might be some association with CBM Managed Services, or they use Cashway as a distributor, or the American Restaurant Association, or whatever. So just in terms of transparency, I know you're a new board. I just kind of suggest you might want to look at this kind of odd situation, because it's really the smallest thing possible. But kind of look at how you conduct yourselves to promote the greatest visibility and public confidence possible. Thank you.
I did get a couple free cookies over there. Is that a
well, and I don't know if you guys go off to your NACO meetings mm-hmm. or Association of Kansas Counties or whatever. You know, they probably pass out ballpoint pens and things mm-hmm. like that. And if it's just
this is from the hotel here.
Okay, but just kind of be aware of that other side of things. Mm-hmm. If anything happened, it kind of generates to me confirmation that the food service management company lawyers are a force to be dealt with.
I've never received anything except a cookie that you made for us. Has anybody else received anything?
I've actually never heard of them until they came on board here. I've never seen them at Fort Worth or New Orleans or any of the other places.
And I've never seen any other food services there.
Never
period.
Seen a food service no. at any one of them.
Well, I tried to go to Kansas Association of Counties meetings, and I had missed the registration deadline, and they made it clear they were full. So to the ability I can tell, I've not been able to research it. But if you do get a chance to go to a food show, it's a lot of fun. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Norman Mantle with Pleasant Hill Road. About term limits, we need term limits, because if you're in there too long.
Can we do this at the next part? Because it's on the agenda.
This is actually on the agenda.
And we're
going to
have you come up and speak at that time. It'll be more effective then.
Item 5 and 6.
Yep.
Norman.
So, and okay. we should have done the same thing with Mr. Montgomery.
You'll have plenty of time.
Okay.
We want to hear from you, but it would be better at that time.
Gotcha. Okay. The word keeps being passed around, statutes. Statute of limits are unconstitutional. Has been since 1803. The U.S. Supreme Court ruled in 1803, statute of limitations are unconstitutional. 4-1 decision, Marbury versus Madison, look it up. Subsequently, since then, lower federal and state courts have upheld this statute. So statute of limits are unconstitutional. I've had a lawyer tell me, he says, yes, you're right, but you will not find a lawyer that will take your case because they don't want to contradict the Constitution.
Is the president is a statute of limitations, isn't it? Two four-year terms?
That's an elected official.
Well, we elect
We're
these
talking
people.
About statute of limitations.
Okay.
So it's been upheld for over 200 years. Since 1803. So when you start talking dates, limits, it's unconstitutional. And it'll take a two-thirds majority of all the states to change it. That's why they are upholding it in the courts. So you mentioned a date, like upstairs, you were talking about October the 5th. Doesn't apply. It's illegal. Any date you mentioned the statute of limitations?
Well, there's sure a lot of them out there.
As I said, you won't find a lawyer to take the case. They don't want to, as they say, ruffle the feathers.
All right. Thank you. Anyone else that would like to come forward at this time? Not seeing anyone, I'll bring it back to the commission. Item number one.
Item number one is a proclamation declaring April 2015 as National County Government Month. Thank you. I'll read that proclamation here. National County Government Month, April 2015. Counties moving America forward. The keys are transportation and infrastructure. Whereas counties move America forward by building infrastructure, maintaining roads and bridges, providing health care, administering justice, keeping communities safe, running elections, managing solid waste, keeping records, and much more. And whereas Saline County and all counties take pride in their responsibility to protect and enhance the health, welfare, and safety of its residents in efficient and cost-effective ways. Whereas through the National Association of Counties President Ricky Hokama Transportation and Infrastructure Initiative, NACO is encouraging counties to focus on how they have improved their communities through road projects, new bridges, building new facilities, water and sewer improvements, and other public works activities. And whereas in order to remain healthy, vibrant, safe, and economically competitive, America's counties provide transportation and infrastructure services that play a key role in everything from residents' daily commutes to shipping goods around the world. And whereas each year since 1991, the National Association of Counties has encouraged counties across the country to actively promote their own programs and services to the public they serve. And now, therefore, be it resolved that the Board of County Commissioners of Saline County, Kansas, do hereby proclaim April 2015 as National County Government Month and encourage all county officials, employees, schools, and residents to participate in county government celebration activities. Adopted this 31st day of March 2015, and this proclamation has been signed by all five county commissioners. And at this time, we have a staff report by Rita Deister, our administrator.
Throughout the month of April, we'll be showcasing our different departments. Road and Bridge will be bringing up one of their brand new road graders and parking it out in front of the building so people can kind of get on and explore what a road grader experience would be like. We'll have GIS will be setting up a table in front of their office showcasing some of their maps that they have done for different entities in the community. Rebecca Seaman, the Register of Deeds, will have a table displaying the passport services that she provides, as well as some of the other services that the Register of Deeds office provides. During the month, at each of our monthly meetings, we'll be recognizing different volunteers. So we have quite a month set up for us, and we really want to also say thank you for all of our county staff for the hard work they do all year long. So,
agreed. Thank you very much. Is there a motion on this?
Mr. Chairman, I move that we declare April 2015 as National County Government Month.
There's a second?
I'll second.
It's a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Passes 5-0. Item number two.
RFA 130-15 is request by the Road and Bridge Department to purchase a 2015 extended cab three-quarter ton pickup with a Napide topper. And Dave Nowak, Director of Road and Bridge, will give you a staff report.
Thank you.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, Commissioners.
Good morning.
Commissioners, this is for your consideration here this morning to award the purchase of one new unused 2015 extended cab two-wheel drive three-quarter ton pickup with a knapheide topper. Seal bids were opened on March the 10th here at the City County Building. We received two bids. Long MacArthur here in Salina had a bid of $34,519.32. Marshall Motors of Salina, Kansas had a bid of $34,627.00. They were very close, the bids. The bid documents were checked and found to be in compliance with specifications. Just to give you an idea, this vehicle that we're looking at here would be used by the engineering department and the technical staff. The vehicle would be used for project inspection, the bridge inspection, preliminary surveying for our projects. Some used pretty extensively. Very important vehicle in our fleet. Staff recommends that you would accept this low bid of $34,519.32 for this 2015 extended cab two-wheel drive three-quarter ton pickup with the knapheide utility or the knapheide topper, and award this to Long MacArthur here of Salina, Kansas. We have currently in our fund $91,339,000, so we have sufficient funds for the purchase of this. It was part of our five-year EIP, the 2015 year here for this vehicle to be purchased. So we're on track with our plans. In fact, this request for action and the one following, this will finish up the equipment that we had on our EIP for this year.
Questions staff at this time? Mm-hmm.
Well, you are going to keep the old truck and move it down the road, and then maybe there's
let me just say the vehicle that we're currently using is pretty much had the goodie out of it. This most likely would be something we may see come showing up on a purple wave somewhere, maybe down the road.
Okay, but if it was anything left in it, you'll keep using it until
yes.
Yes. And you have to, all these trucks have a property number, I imagine.
They do have a unit number, yes.
And before you ever sell that to Purple Wave, you bring it before the commission and get their approval.
We cannot sell anything without commissioner's approval. Everything that we have it's public property.
Even a chair.
So I have no authority to let anything go without commissioner's direction. And in the past with the Purple Wave stuff, that's what we've done. We've created a list and we have brought that before the commissioners for their review and sought approval for us to move forward with those type of activities.
Do they ever, you were talking about an audit coming up here for those funds? For the equipment funds, we're gonna, the auditors kind of advise you what to do.
Oh, the
on
transfer
that.
Of funds. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Do they ever? I was talking to somebody from K-State last week, and every once in a while they come in and they'll take every 15th number of the property, and they'll say, "We want to see that." Have we ever been audited like that as a county? The state does that pretty regularly.
No, we don't have anything like that.
Auditors don't do
that.
Well,
we do an annual inventory and have to turn it into the county clerks to make sure that the property is accounted for.
But we're never audited on it?
No.
What if someone...
I think the auditor does look at that inventory, but he doesn't...
Yeah, I mean, that'd be part
He doesn't go out and physically see if something is there.
Yeah, it's every desk, every chair, every computer... motor grader, dump truck, everything is on that inventory.
When they ask for these items, there might be these movie things that they might have several of them in the county, you know, and they have to run, and they had to send some students out and find these, to know where these are at, and then they asked them, why do you do that? And they said, well, because a lot of things get stolen and pawned, and it's not off the inventory, so it needs to be done once in a while to know that.
Well, that's the job of the clerks to take that inventory and make sure. I mean, people have to show that it's there, and we'll question if they can't find it. So.
And then they also audit. The state has the same. The reason we bring this before the board to buy this truck, the board has to approve this because it's. Why do we have to approve this? Why don't you just purchase it?
Well, by policy, it's exceeding $3,000, which is my authority, and it's exceeding $5,000, which is the county administrator's authority. So by policy, once we get more than $5,000, by policy, we have to bring it before the county commissioners.
So your policy is different than the county's policy? You can approve $5,000 and they can only approve $3,000?
Yeah, that's in our policy, our purchasing policy.
When you do that purchase, do you usually say it's over the a larger limit? I didn't realize myself there was a $5,000.
Well, it's only limit. Under there's certain conditions in which you can do that. Like if it's
well, you did it for that Bobcat because
right,
it was an emergency.
Right,
we had to
right,
have it done that
right,
day. And
right.
I noticed when I did the billing that we spent $4,200 on heaters, and I never knew anything about that.
Heaters.
That shop heaters at the road and bridge.
There's a lot of quotes that we take.
A lot of what?
We take quotes. We have a mm-hmm. quote sheet that we fill out, whether it's for culverts, mm-hmm. grader blades, tires, and if it's $3,000 or less, I can sign off and
right.
move forward. Mm-hmm. If it's greater than that, I bring it to Rita, and she has a limit of up to $5,000, so mm-hmm. so she can sign off on those quote sheets. And we can move forward with it then. But again, once it exceeds $5,000, this is where we should be bringing it mm-hmm. before you as the county commissioner.
Well, that was over a month ago. They put those heaters in, and I hadn't heard anything about it from anybody.
No, we had some that were out, and we had to replace mm-hmm. them.
Well, they do have to be replaced, yeah. but it looks like it was over $3,000. You must have turned it over to Rita, and then she approved it for $4,200. But when it was an emergency thing, and that's an emergency, we got to have heaters. I mean,
yeah.
there's no doubt that we would replace the heaters, but it looks like the commissioners would have been informed that they spent $4,200 on heaters. The reason I know it, I saw it when I read the billing. And I think that's
well,
a little.
They were putting them heaters in when we went on the.
Yeah. I didn't
yeah.
But
yeah.
I did look at it and saw it on the billing
yep.
last. Probably 6 weeks ago,
mm-hmm.
and I've kind of set back to hear if somebody's going to inform us what that you had fixed the heaters, which you got to fix. I mean, but I,
oh, yeah.
you're not going to go out and buy a truck for $30,000, and
no.
I think that's where commissioners come in. We need to know where the money's being spent, and that's in the state. Anything spent over $3,000, they audit those too. So I'm a little concerned about that. I don't know.
Well, that's the reason you get those bills to look at and review, and
well,
so and you sign off on the bills, so everything's
passed by. I would
you
think as staff and administrator, you would tell us that you put new heaters in. We should know those things.
Any further question on this issue? Is there any public comment?
Ray Ruska, 235 North Santa Fe. Rita made a comment here just a few minutes ago about the policy number that's in the Saline County manual. Can you quote that policy number so that I could look that up?
I cannot quote it to you, but if you come by my office, I'll look it up myself. I go to my policy book and look in the index every time. I can't remember all of them.
Well, I just would like to make sure it's clear, you know, about the 3,000 or the 5,000. And you said you did sign off on the 5K limit.
I have before. I don't remember the heaters, but I might have done it. I mean,
that's kind of important, I think.
Yeah.
You got kind of some smirks on the faces out here, but that's why we're appointed as commissioners to keep an eye on. If you would buy a $30,000 truck without telling us, it would really be screaming. If you buy if you're allowed to spend $3,000. Then you're allowed to do that, but if you spend $3,200, you've gone over the policy and you've broken the policy. It doesn't matter if it's $3,200 or $32,000. We need to know these facts of what's being spent, and I'm keeping my eye out, and that's my job, and that's your job,
yep.
and Lucy, it's your job, and we need to know these things. because it puts a doubt in my mind that things are being handled right. And makes me think about it. I mentioned this to the state guy, and he told me they have almost identical policies as us. Last year, they came with a new policy wanting to up it to $10,000. And the commissioners last year thought, that's just too much money to turn loose $10,000 without us knowing about it. And it stayed at $3,000. And if the state's at $3,000, I think we're in a pretty good range. But I think, Ray, I didn't know there was a $5,000, so I'll have to go back and read that myself. But I still think when it's spent over, and it's an emergency, the heaters have to be fixed. Not one commissioner would say, we're not going to fix it, because we want to fix that building up and we want to spend money on it. So, but we need to be informed what's going on out there.
So, Rita, you mentioned that you signed off on this. Now, if you signed off on it, that means there's some kind of information or document that you signed to do that.
If I signed off on him, there was a bid sheet, and it would have had three different bids, and it would have been a verbal bid, and I would have signed off on it. And I can't remember signing off on
the. You don't recall ever seeing that?
I see a lot of bid sheets. I see them on rotor grade blades. I see them on tires. I see them on gasoline. I see them on from noxious weed, but I don't remember that particular one. I'm not denying I signed it.
So there is a document somewhere in your office that says you signed off on it.
There would be. Yes.
Thank you very much, Rita.
And Ray, when the state does that audit, they check. They asked this particular person, have you spent over $3,000? And he said yes, and he told them what item's on, and the dean and the board had to sign it off before he could spend the money. So I imagine you would have that approval to do. You didn't just do it without talking to the administrator, right?
Rita and I, we were discussing these things all the time. Mm-hmm.
Well, I'm asking on this particular thing, did you sign anything saying you were allowed to do that?
I can't help but believe that, yes, I did, but I can't recall it just off the top of my head. I'm sorry, John.
Five weeks ago, I wouldn't think you could forget that.
I think that this is something for another day. This really doesn't have any. And I'm not saying it's not important at all.
Well,
I'm not saying
it's not. I wanted to bring it out publicly.
I got you. It's just that.
It's just like last week we found out that they settled the lawsuit with Mr. Smith for $20,000. I never knew anything about that until I asked the question last week. When was that settled? Do you recall when that was settled?
No, I do not.
It had to be after the first of the year, probably. Well, I think commissioners, did you know that? Well, we didn't know it until last week. And I think those things need to be.
I think they're important.
The public
needs to
know what we've done. And not for us, but for the public. Mm-hmm. They need to know where the money's spent and what's going on.
We could bring that up at another time, appropriate time, and I'd be happy to.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Those are some good points, Commissioner Price. Thank you for bringing it up.
Anything else, a public comment on this item? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Mr. Chair, I move that we approve request RFA 130-15 by the Road and Bridge to purchase a 2015 extended cab 3/4 ton pickup in the value of $34,519.32.
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
Passes 5-0. Item number 3.
Request for action 131-15. Again, a request by Road and Bridge to purchase a 2015 extended cab 1-ton pickup with a Naphide utility bed. Dave Nowak, Director.
Commissioners, this request for action is again for your consideration to award for the purchase of one new unused 2015 crew cab. Two-wheel drive, 1-ton, full-size pickup with a Naphide utility box. Seal bids, again, were open on March 10th here at the City County Building. We had two bids that were received. Long MacArthur here in Salina, Kansas submitted a bid of $38,980. Marshall Motors here in Salina, Kansas submitted a bid of $40,879,000. The bid documents were checked and they were found to be in compliance with the specifications. Again, this is a piece of equipment that we use within our Road and Bridge Department. It is used on for a crew. A crew usually consists of four people. This vehicle would be a vehicle that would transport the four people to the job sites. It would also be with the utility box. This piece of equipment would be carrying all the tools that are required that they need on the job site as well. So it's something that is used daily and a very important piece of equipment in our fleet. Our recommendation is to accept the low bid of $38,980 and to award this for the purchase to Long MacArthur here in Salina, Kansas. Again, I had indicated earlier that we had $91,339 left in our line item within the Road and Bridge Department. With the purchase of this and the one that you previously approved, that will leave a remaining amount in this line item of $17,839.68. Commissioners, questions for me on this?
This is one that's going to move on. You're going to hand me down this truck?
We have three crews, and we have three of these type of vehicles that we use for our crews. And the existing one that we have, again, we'll continue to use it. Our rural patrolmen that come in at times, they team up and go out together, will take a truck like this out with them, and that way they have the tools and the fuel for the chainsaws and such. So again, it will probably continue to be used within our fleet, but that doesn't mean there may be another one that may be bumped somewhere here and end up on the purple wave list as we move forward.
Okay, well, I just understood you to say the other day in our study station that it moved down. Somebody inherits this and moves on down.
I was not here last week, and I wasn't part of that. I know, but so forgive me.
Darren said.
I can't relate to that discussion. I'm sorry.
Okay.
That's fine. Get the most out of me.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay.
Further questions? Public comment?
Yeah, Norman Manilis, Pleasant Hill Road. What was the bid submitted for, an extended cab or a crew cab, Dave? Makes a difference in the price.
Well, they're taking the crew out. They're taking four, five, six people.
But the extended cab is here on the paper.
No, the bottom one's it is.
It is.
They are extended cabs.
Mm-hmm. The one they're talking about here, Norman, is a crew cab. Mm-hmm. It's
I'm just going
cab.
By the paper.
Yeah,
what I see.
That might be a mistake in the printing there. Yeah,
it's possible.
It is. It's a mistake.
It's
on
a crew
there,
cab.
But it is a crew cab. Mm-hmm. Well, the one ton's a crew cab. Am I right, David?
That's correct.
Yeah. Well, and it depends on the make of the vehicle, too, because Dodge does not make an extended cab. All they make is a crew cab. So we're having a price discrepancy here.
We actually go to out-of-town places for bids also. It's not just...
I'm just going
here.
By what you got.
No. It is a crew. Does your paperwork show that it's an
extended?
It says
extended cab, both
extended
of them, item two
three.
And three.
Mm-hmm. It does say it.
But on the bottom part, we accept the bid as a crew cab. So it was just a mistake.
I just want to know because
that's a mistake.
That's several thousand dollars difference between extended cab and a crew cab. I've got both vehicles and cost quite a bit more for the crew cab.
Yeah. May I make a comment here?
Yeah.
One of them is for a 3/4 ton and one of them is a 1 ton. Mm-hmm. There is a difference between the two that we're looking at here today.
Mm-hmm. The previous one was an extended cab.
Yes.
Well.
And this one is a crew cab, but just a typo on that.
Okay, but I heard Dave say crew cab. Mm-hmm.
It is a crew.
I understand that, but I just wanted to clear that up on the
page.
Yes.
Thank you.
It was a mistake. Thanks for bringing that to our attention.
Further public comment? Commission action?
I make a motion, Mr. Chairman, that we accept the bids in the amount of $38,980 from Long MacArthur, Inc. to purchase a 2015 crew cab, and it's a two-wheel drive, one-ton, full-size pickup with a utility bed.
Yep. Is there a second?
I second that.
It's a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Passes 5-0. Item number 4.
Request for action 132-15, request by a sheriff's office to purchase four police SUVs. I have a staff report by Captain Roger Soldan.
Captain?
Good morning. We requested for new vehicles in the equipment improvement program for this year and received funding for four vehicles. We worked with the Administrative Resource Center and requested bids for four equipped police SUVs. We did receive bids back from Shawnee Mission Ford and Long MacArthur of Salina. In reviewing the bid documents, Shawnee Mission Ford didn't meet the specifications in a couple of categories. We are making a recommendation to award the purchase to Long MacArthur of Salina, including trade-in of our current vehicles for $138,559, which is under the amount that was in our equipment improvement program funds for this year.
Okay, questions of Captain Solden?
And I just want to commend them that they were $3,700 under the estimate. So you guys came in under, they came in under the bid.
It's always good.
It's good to know when the price tag is that big.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. These are special vehicles that are a lot heavier duty than your average SUV, aren't they?
Yes.
These are police package.
Right. These are the police package. Yeah, like you purchased last year. We purchased two last year, and they've served really well.
They have much heavier brakes and
the electrical system, brakes,
everything is much heavy duty compared to a regular SUV.
Yes.
And they're made for the back roads and stuff. Mm-hmm.
Is there public comment on this? Bring it back to the commission for action.
Mr. Chairman, I move we accept the bid in the amount of $138,559 to the purchase of four 2015 all-wheel drive police package SUVs for the Sheriff's Office at Long MacArthur Ford.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
So motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Passes 5-0. Item number 5.
RFA 133-15, a request by Planning and Zoning to appoint three members to the Planning Commission. David Neal, Director.
Mr. Neal.
Morning, Commissioners. If it's okay with the Commission, I'm going to discuss items 5 and 6 together. They're very similar. What we're looking at today is appointing Planning Commission members and Board of Zoning Appeal members. For the Planning Commission, Mr. Jim Juergensmeyer, Brett Ferguson, and Ken Stromberg have ended their term and are up for another appointment, so there are three vacant seats. There has been a change to this. Mr. Clayton Short has decided to resign as commissioner. He's going to pursue some of the other farm boards that he's been working on and wants to put more effort forth in there. And the Planning Commission is a big effort and as far as time for him. So there are now four open seats, and that is not reflected in this report. I should start off with the Planning Commission. If you decide not to appoint anybody to the board, the Planning Commission will continue to operate. It has the proper membership to do that. The commission can be anywhere from 5 to 9 members, as long as the majority of members are from an unincorporated area of Saline County. When you look at the list of candidates, I did include Jim Juergensmeyer, as term limits have not been set yet, so he is eligible, but I understand the commission is not looking at reappointing him. The other candidates, Brett Ferguson and Ken Stromberg, I would recommend in reappointing for their experience. And then the last three, we have expression of interest in the last year from Daniel Baffa, Deborah Bloomquist, and Robert Vidrickson. You'll notice on there that I marked if they are rural or city residents. That's to indicate if they're unincorporated or incorporated areas. When you decide to appoint to the Planning Commission, if you are expecting to fill all four seats, at least two of the positions have to be rural residents.
Two on the whole?
Out of everybody selected for the four seats.
Okay.
The majority, so correct. The majority of the board, that would keep that majority as unincorporated residents.
Okay.
And if you'd like, we can start with a motion for the Planning Commission. You can appoint people individually or just name, create a list of names and appoint everybody in the same motion. What I will end up doing in your packet, you'll see a sample resolution. I will have the names filled into those resolutions and ready for you to sign next week.
My only question real quickly here is, can someone serve on both of these? Can they be on the planning and the zone of appeals?
Mm-hmm. one person is allowed to serve both the Planning Commission and the Board of Zoning Appeals. And I should point out that anybody serving on the Planning Commission is more than welcome to serve on CDIC or any of the other. There is no restriction to the number of county boards, at least on my boards. I'm not sure about the other board policies.
Okay.
But only one person from the Planning Commission can serve on the Board of Zoning Appeals. At this time, Mr. Tom Rickstrew is the one person serving on both boards.
Okay. And my reason for asking is because the current applicants, some of them have on their interest, expression of interest form, they have
several boards.
Have put, yes.
Correct. So, for instance, I think one of them has CDIC listed as well as Planning Commission and Board of Zoning Appeals.
Correct.
You could appoint them to either Planning Commission or Board of Zoning Appeals. You can also appoint them to CDIC if it meets the policies for that board.
Well, Mr. Vidrickson also has one of the expression of interest applicants has Board of Zoning and also Planning. So that was my
correct
question on asking that. Okay. And you're needing four seats on planning, and how many on zoning?
For the Board of Zoning Appeals, the Board of Zoning Appeals can be anywhere from 3 to 7 members. I did talk to Mr. Darvin Dent. He is willing to continue serving on the Board of Zoning Appeals, but he indicated he's considerably busy and not up for the time commitment. Mm-hmm. I believe in his words, if somebody else is willing to take his place, he's happy to step down. But fortunately, the Board of Zoning Appeals is not as much of a time commitment.
Okay.
For that board, we will, including Mr. Dent's position that's now open, we would have a total of 3 vacant seats.
I am, that Mr. Short has resigned is all new to us. I'd never heard
yes
until right now.
He
so I would like to work on the 3 that we've kind of decided on for now, and we can appoint another one at a later time. Has somebody been appoint, they'll vote to point, take somebody, take his place, I imagine.
Correct, as
Mr.
far as
Short
chairman, mm-hmm, yes.
So I think I'd be happy with just doing 3 today because we really haven't had time to study for 4.
And that's up to the commissions.
Mm-hmm.
I would be all right with 3, but I think we need to keep Durgesmeyer on there because of experience. And since Clayton has resigned and we have not passed that other resolution
correct
at this point, so I hope we look at that.
Further questions of staff at this time before I open it up to public comment? All right, sir, public comment at this time.
Yeah, go ahead, Ray. I'm a little confused here. Didn't you say earlier, David, that Mr. Flattery resigned? Or was it Clayton Short resigned?
The only thing I've said is Mr. Short has resigned.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I thought you said Flattery. Mm-hmm. Excuse me, I didn't catch that. Mm-hmm. there's one thing I'd like you to bring up in the planning and zoning laws that they have in effect at this present time. The Article 9 of the amendments says these bylaws may be amended at any regular meeting of the commission by 2/3 vote of the members present, provided that any proposed amendment shall have been submitted in writing at the previous regular meeting. Was that, you're getting ready to change some of the bylaw conditions here, and there seems to be a contradiction there. Are the bylaws being circumvented? Has there been a meeting? Has an amendment been submitted at a previous regular meeting? I mean, has that been done, Mr. Neal?
Let me clarify. The items on the agenda today mm-hmm are for the appointment of planning commissioners and Board of Zoning Appeals. Mm-hmm. There is no proposed change to a bylaw. There is no proposed change to a county commission regulation, which are 2 separate items.
And that's a really good point, Ray. And I think it would have been a good time. We were really short on our counselor today. We're short. We were here 1 minute before it was time to start. And that would have been a really good thing to bring up to our counselor, because I'm sure that he would be aware of that, you know, and if he isn't, then he needs to be made aware of it. And before we continue of making that change, it's gonna take months to do that. Not something, and we haven't voted on to make that change yet. But it's what we're considering and thinking about doing. So at this time, anybody would be qualified to be appointed, because we haven't changed that yet. But we are talking about it. And David, were you aware of that?
The bylaws are a completely separate thing. That is bylaws that the board has decided to function according to the board themselves. Mm-hmm. That is not a county regulation. When you're talking term limits, the application has been made for term limits. That is a county regulation. Mm-hmm. That is completely separate from bylaws. Can't confuse the two. Mm-hmm.
And at this time, because we haven't voted on that, we can use our own discretion whether we want to vote on somebody over.
Correct.
Period. That's our own. Dave, you're saying one, thinking one way, I might be thinking another, and that's, we can vote that way now however we feel.
Correct.
So.
One final comment.
And I think it should be a good public discussion about it.
I agree.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. We need to have a good public discussion, even though it isn't changing the bylaws, you know.
This is kind of confusing here. Here we're getting ready to, all of a sudden there's three or four members on the planning and zoning that going to need to be appointed. Since the planning and zoning was created by the county commissioners, perhaps it's time to eliminate that department. There's a lot of disruption going on down there that nobody's, you know, addressing the issues. And if we have these kind of people that were trying to make a statement based on, let's get out of here, those aren't the people we want on that board to start with.
Well, we did have a discussion last week about this, and we said we need to, we talked about the public input and stuff, and we are discussing, aren't we? I mean, you were there last week, weren't you?
I was, yeah.
Well, we did make a...
Which board are you referring to?
Planning and zoning.
Okay. Mm-hmm. I was reading.
Well, and we discussed that last week, and we have different opinions of things that we think should be done.
Well,
so
since the county commissioners created this board, mm-hmm. and they can dissolve it just as easily as just making a vote. Now, do we really need planning and zoning? That's the question. Mm-hmm. Or do we need planning and zoning? When we see this kind of disruption going on one of the boards that you appointed, it reflects back to you. And I think you should probably look at that real close.
Well, I think most counties have a planning and zoning, and I'm not thinking that we don't need a planning and zoning, Ray. If we're going to do that, let's just drop the zoning laws altogether.
I'm not trying to promote that. Yeah,
I'm just saying
there are a lot of confusion,
Mr. Chairman,
going on here.
Point of order, if we can get back to the topic of the agenda.
Mm-hmm. Yep, thank you.
Is there any further public comments on what's on the agenda?
Thank you.
Yeah, Norman Minor, West Pleasant Hill Road. To reappoint previous planning commissioners can create a conflict of interest. In other words, it'll soon turn into the good old boy method. Well, we're ruling this place. We're going to do it the way we want. So we need term limits. And it stands for it right here in the common law book. We need to get back to the Constitution, not ruling by I'm the department director or I'm the boss, going to run it my way.
Thank you.
Wayne Montgomery again. I never saw good old boy working in the county on planning commission. I saw people appropriately recuse themselves, take a seat, or even vacate this room when they had any kind of connection with any issue that was before us. I don't buy that. I think that, and I don't see that there's problems down there unless you want to look to where the source of that is. And that would take some integrity, some honesty in the county commission.
Thank you. Further public comments? I'll bring it back to the commission for action, and I'll start out by saying, Dave, Commissioner Smith, were you interested in three or four today, or you were just thinking, tell me what you're thinking about the vice chair? And
Well, the fourth is a kind of surprise to us.
Okay.
So my inclination is to appoint three today, and I would be in favor of reappointing the three that Jurgensmeyer, Fulton, and Stromberg.
I kind of think we almost need to vote on them individually because we're not going to, you mind what you want to, throwing them out there as three people. I don't think we should do it that way. I think we should do maybe somebody making a motion to appoint somebody, and then we vote on that. And I don't know how we would.
I do have I take your point, and I think that might be the right way to do that. I might have a question of one of the applicants here, too. I can speak very, very highly of Mr. Robert Vidrickson as somebody that would be good on this board, and I see that he is here. Bob, can I ask you a quick question? I mean, would you be interested in the, if you didn't get on the Planning Commission, to be on the Zoning Appeals?
Sure.
Okay. That's
okay.
Or maybe he could possibly be the fourth at some time. I mean, I just wanted to know what he thought.
And one thing about, you know, what we're voting on now, whether we appoint somebody that's had an 8-year term or not, there's no rule on that right now.
There's no rule.
So
we're fine.
And another thing, too, if they're off a year, shows one guy's on there a year. After a year, those persons can come back. It's not a,
right.
You're not just done. I mean, it's just a.
That's the way that the application was drafted.
Yeah, it would be just a 1-year term. It wouldn't be, you've got to wait 4 years or 3 years or, you know, it's just 1-year term. So you would be back.
My only question to the rest of the commissioners is, because we were just told today about the fourth open seat, do you feel like we need to ask for more expression of interest forms? Because we've got plenty of applicants to pick from for four. What is your reasoning of waiting to appoint that fourth one, knowing that we were just giving that information today?
Well, because I have looked at three that I would like to appoint, and I haven't thought about the fourth one. You don't just decide right now, well, let's just throw an extra one on. I'd like to have a little time on the fourth one myself.
Because I personally contacted Deborah Bloomquist, knowing that she is the only female that showed expression of interest. She did recently put in her expression of interest form and is still interested. You know, you always want to make sure, especially, you don't know how long ago, we can tell on the dates how long ago they applied, because things change. And I know that she has started her own business and she's very busy, so I asked her if she was still interested, and she is. Her business is growing, it's very stable. She's got managers in positions to where she can dedicate and devote time to this. So I was very interested, excuse me, I got a frog in my throat. I was very interested in seeing her appointed to this. I know some of the people that are currently on that. I do not know Leslie Berndt. Is that a gentleman or a woman?
Leslie Berndt is a gentleman farmer out in the county.
Okay. He's got a name that can go either way with genders.
Yes.
So that was my question on that. So I was very interested in seeing that a female had shown expression of interest.
And 2 years ago, we had two females, I think, on the board, and they had resigned.
They did.
It was over all that zoning stuff. They got a little upset about things. But anyway, we have had late. They were just not too long ago. And I agree with you. One of the things we have to look at there is she's city, and we can only have if.
Well, you're going to have half of the rural. He said you needed.
You always have to have a majority of rural unincorporated residents. Just for clarification for the board, if you're voting on three, two have to be unincorporated residents. If you're voting on four, two have to be unincorporated residents, and that will maintain the total majority as unincorporated.
So in other words,
either two.
Bob
or
Deborah
will be the only one that's qualified because of the makeup of the board.
This is kind of a hard vote.
If
hard
you're voting for four, you could elect, for instance, Brett and Ken, and then Bob and Deborah both, and that would still, like I said, at least two have to be rural residents.
So it does make a difference when we're going to decide on that fourth person.
Right. Could we, as commissioners, recommend? I'm still thinking three today, and I don't. And could we each recommend three, and then out of those votes of the three that we've picked, the ones with the most three votes, could we do that? I mean, we're going to have to vote on them somehow.
It's up to the board how you want to select
people. It would be kind of simple instead of going one at a time if we each made a motion for three and you calculated it, and then the ones that got, it's kind of like the city, when the city people are elected, it's the ones that get the most votes. And that'd be a pretty simple way to do it, you know, you see what I'm saying? And then we could vote on all three of those to bring them in.
If that's what the board would like to do, we can tally preferences and...
If you just had one or two, it's not so hard, but when you have four, you know.
Well, we do have some very qualified applicants,
right.
And that's,
yeah.
That's a good, great
right.
problem to
mm-hmm.
have. But we have also have two boards to fill today,
mm-hmm.
too. So a couple of them have expressed interest in both boards.
Exactly.
Well, I guess
the more and more I think about this today, I'm okay with doing four. I understand
okay.
where you're coming
mm-hmm.
from. I do, but I think we've got qualified mm-hmm. applicants in. I'm comfortable with moving ahead with four.
If we do four, is Shorts in the county, so we can still only have one city person, though.
No, you would be able to, if you're voting for four, you would be able to select two of the city applicants, and you would have to have two rural applicants.
Okay.
As
so
long
we,
as the
so
majority.
So we could have two city then.
Correct.
Okay, well, that wouldn't be so hard then.
If I can just ask, how does that apply to the appeals?
For the appeal board, it is the same process, but fortunately for the appeals board, everybody currently, and I'm including Mr. Dent on this, everybody is currently an unincorporated resident, so it's pretty much
but it's got the same, it's
same
you
majority.
Need to have at least a majority of the rural.
Correct.
Okay.
Well, could I make that motion that we each give four names and we take the majority of the four names? Could I make that motion as how we make this vote to make it simple? Then we could vote on those four people that we agree on.
And then you would vote on them
as a group.
As a group
mm-hmm.
instead, so there'd just be one
right.
motion.
Mm-hmm. Make it a lot simpler.
I don't know if it would make it simpler.
Yeah,
would
no,
it
that
not?
Sounds more confusing.
Can we take them one? Excuse me.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I think we need to take
Public
them one at
Wayne.
A time.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, to expedite the thing, take them one at a time.
Yeah.
If the person carries, they don't.
Right.
So then you extend on down and take the recommendations that you want to put on the others.
Yeah, I agree with
Let's just go ahead and do it.
I would agree with the same process because in the past you've always done it by one at a time.
Right. Well, we haven't always. They tried to do it several at a time,
much.
And we said no.
And are we going to try to? Do you want to fill four seats?
I'm comfortable with four, and I appreciate Commissioner Price's
right.
comment, but
yeah.
I.
Dave, are you okay with four?
Okay with four.
Well, since there's two city people coming on now, I'm a lot more comfortable.
Okay, that's
okay.
fine.
If we only had one city, then you got to really make that choice. But since there's two,
okay.
Shall we just start at the top of that list and vote on each one?
Well, I would entertain a motion on somebody, but I'm going to be very supportive of two of the members to be reappointed, and then Deborah Bloomquist and Robert Bidrickson. I would like to see on.
And,
I just wanted to. Say that, but that's...
Well, I guess I would make a motion, then we vote on Robert Vidrickson.
All right.
And anybody second that?
Is there a second?
I'll second that.
All right. There's a motion and a second to appoint Robert Vidrickson to the Planning and Zoning Board as...
Can we have Don call a vote on these so we'll have the record of it?
You
okay.
betcha.
Okay.
Clerk, call the roll, please.
Commissioner Shedwick?
Aye.
Commissioner Guile?
Aye.
Commissioner Larson?
Aye.
Commissioner Price?
Aye.
And Commissioner Smith?
Aye.
Okay, that's 5-0.
Okay.
Is there a motion for?
I move that we also appoint Deborah Bloomquist to the Planning and Zoning Board.
I'd second that motion.
There's a motion and a second. Will the clerk call the roll, please?
Excuse me. Commissioner Shedwick?
Aye.
Commissioner Price?
Aye.
Commissioner Guile?
Aye.
Commissioner Larson?
Aye.
Commissioner Smith?
Aye.
5-0.
I guess
I make a motion for Brett Ferguson.
It's a motion for Brett Ferguson. Does everybody need to look at?
I'd second that motion also.
So motion and a second, and I did not open it up for public comment on the last one. I apologize. Is there public comment at this time?
In the packet, I've noticed a misspelling of a word, and it's called a sample resolution. The name, number, and signatures is misspelled. They spelled it incorrectly. I would like to point that out and make sure it's corrected.
For who?
Anyone you're voting for.
Oh, okay.
So,
okay.
It was just a typo, and I'm assuming that Rita made these out.
No.
Well, somebody else.
No idea.
Well,
you know.
And I'm sure our county clerk will get it figured out for us, the right spelling.
I think we can figure that out.
Yeah, we will. Thank you.
Thank you.
There's the motion and a second. Any discussion? Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Shedwick.
Aye.
Commissioner Price.
Aye.
Commissioner Guile.
Aye.
Commissioner Larson.
Aye.
Commissioner Smith.
Aye.
Okay. 5-0.
And
Mr.
I move
Chairman,
that the. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
I would like to make a motion to appoint Mr. Durgesmeyer.
I'll second that.
All right, there's a motion and a second. Is there any discussion? Public comment?
Commissioners, just for my own recommendation and discussions with Mr. Jurgensmeyer, he is happy to serve and happy to continue serving, but at the same time, he has generally the same attitude that Mr. Dent does, that he is busy with his business. If somebody else would like to take his place, he's more than welcome to.
Okay. That being said, just as comment before the vote happens, I would probably vote nay on this and vote to reappoint Ken. So
we need to vote on him first.
Yes, yeah, we do. It's just
can
a comment.
Second it on him?
There was
yes,
a motion
sir.
And a second, and that was just discussion.
Okay.
Will the clerk call the roll?
Commissioner Shedwick.
Nay.
Commissioner Price.
Nay.
Get these recorded here, right? Commissioner Guile.
Nay.
Commissioner Larson.
Nay.
And Commissioner Smith.
Yes.
That fails, what, 1-4? Is there another motion?
Well, I make a motion that we appoint Ken Stromberg to the Planning and Zoning.
I second that.
There's a motion and a second. Any discussion? Public comment? Will the clerk call the roll?
Commissioner Shedwick.
Aye.
Commissioner Price.
Aye.
Commissioner Guile.
Aye.
Commissioner Larson.
Aye.
And Commissioner Smith.
Aye.
That passes
5-0.
All right. Thank you. Thank you for your report.
Board of Zoning Appeals, if
right.
you would like to appoint anybody to that board, as I mentioned, they can operate without any appointments. Mr. Dent is up for reappointment. The only person left on the list is Daniel Baffa as an extra nomination to fill one of the vacant seats. And there's no consideration on rural or because the majority is rural by far.
Okay, how many are you wanting to appoint?
There are a total of 3 empty seats. You only have 2 candidates.
Okay.
So we can make a motion to appoint both of those. We better do it separate again, Adam.
Yeah. Is there a motion?
Well, I make a motion that we reappoint Garvin Dent.
Is there a second?
I second that.
Any discussion? Public comment? Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Shedwick.
Aye.
Commissioner Price.
Aye.
Commissioner Guile.
Aye.
Commissioner Larson.
Aye.
And Commissioner Smith.
Aye.
Thank you.
I'd entertain one more motion.
I move that we appoint Daniel Baffa to the Planning and Zoning.
Appeals.
Board
of Zoning Appeals.
Zoning Appeals.
There's a motion, a second. Discussion? Public comment? Clerk, call the roll.
Commissioner Shedwick.
Aye.
Commissioner Price.
Aye.
Commissioner Guile.
Aye.
Commissioner Larson.
Aye.
And Commissioner Smith.
Aye.
Thank you.
That passes 5-0. Thank you for your report and everything.
Just for clarity on your part, these people, if they are interested, are more than welcome to serve on any of the other county boards. Mm-hmm. I always encourage any volunteering we can get.
Okay.
And anybody interested, please fill out a letter of interest and for any of the county boards.
And the other thing I wanted to point out is that we still have not appointed anyone to the Salina Economic Development Incentive Council.
Why haven't we done that? We just need to do it, right?
I know. I think we were waiting to see if we were going to get other expression of interest on that, and I do not know if we have received any more for the CDIC.
I haven't seen them, but Sue may have them.
Okay. So just wanted to keep that.
We could get that on the agenda for next week.
Yep.
Everybody okay with that?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Anybody that is interested in that, I would ask that they get on the website to print it out, to fill it in, and get it to us this week, and we'd be happy to look at it. That's an important position. I know they haven't met a lot lately, but it is important. We do need to get that position filled, and we'll put that on the agenda next week. All right, item number 7.
Approval of County Commission minutes of the week of March 24th, 2015.
Mr. Chairman, I make a motion that we approve, or I move that we approve the County Commission minutes of March 24th, 2015.
I second that.
There's a motion and a second. Is there any public comment?
I really, for some reason, I couldn't download it, and I haven't got to read it yet. Has anybody seen any mistakes in it? Ray, you got a mistake in there or anything?
I was going to ask Don a question about the amended minutes. I read both minutes, but I couldn't figure out what was different.
We just added a couple things that Commissioner Shadwick had signed. I didn't know he had signed them until they were laying on my desk or somebody brought them in. I just added those for record. The signature was for the CBM amendment to their food contract for the jail, and then the other one was for a health department. The wording escapes me. I'll look at the minutes here, but it was something that I didn't know about, and I added it later. It was brought to my attention. And unfortunately, I don't have that in front of me, but it was the last two items that was added to the document signed there. If I may, could I?
Sure.
Thank you. What I added to it was CBM Managed Services Food Contract Amendment Number 6 for hot meal service at the jail, and that signed by Commissioner Shadwick. Environmental Sustainability by the Health Department Modification of Agreement, also signed by Commissioner Shadwick and also by Mayor Aaron Householder. And that's all I added to him.
Now, we had discussed that first one last week, right? It just wasn't.
Yeah, right.
So you just added it afterward. I mean, that's nothing that we didn't already know about.
No.
We do know that we gave him permission, so he had to get with Aaron.
Right. So well, and yeah, Mayor Householder had to sign him as well. So.
All right. Any other comments?
Well, I just wanted to comment that thank you for staying on top of the details, Don. You're doing a good job.
I try sometimes.
Even during
it's a little
election,
tough, but I try.
Even during election, he's doing it, isn't he?
All right, there's a motion and a second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye. Aye.
Passes 5-0. Is there any other business that needs to come before the commission today? Are there any announcements that need to, any announcements?
A couple things, if I may. Ongoing advance voting for the April 7th election is coming up a week from today. It's come up on us pretty quick. We've had 338 people vote in office. That's as of first thing this morning, so hopefully we've had a few more this morning. 338 have voted in office. We've mailed out about 500 ballots so far, kind of usual for this city school cycle. Always hope for more, but I'll take whatever we get. The other thing I wanted to comment about and let people know, that of course we all know that we have 5 commissioner districts now that was voted on last November. You can access those districts by going to www.saline.org. Under the county commission, and our mapping department, our GIS department, has set up a map on there where you can look up to see what district you're in. If you don't have any access to a computer of any kind, give the county clerk's office a call, 309-5820, and we can look you up and let you know which district you're in and, of course, who your county commissioner is. If I have budget enough this year, I'll do a mailing to those districts just to let them know that the changes were made. So,
well, you know, we could just mail them to the ones that actually changed.
Well, that's what I'm saying. I'm not going to mail something to everybody, but if they were already in district 1 or 2 or 3, you know, I won't bother them, but all the new ones I would.
But I'd like to point out that the city commission race doesn't matter what district you're in.
Right.
It is nonpartisan. It is citywide inside the city limits. So the county, the five commissioners are county commissioners, and it will matter then when you're voting
in
2016. You have to know your district then. But it's a nonpartisan election right now.
That may change. I hope not. But
all right. Thank you very much, Don. Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you for everyone for attending today.